So, good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Keerthi Catherine Kabir, a breast consultant and oncoplastic surgeon at Kaveri Hospital, Chennai. Firstly, I'd like to wish all the women today for Happy Women's Day. And being Women's Day, we thought we would talk a little bit on the importance of breast health. I think this is an area that gets avoided quite often, mostly because of the stereotype that goes with it. A lot of people are not comfortable talking about their breast health, and that's why we're going to look at the importance of it today. So when we talk about breast health, why are we focusing on it so much these days? And it's purely because the incidence of cancer is going up in the women population in India. And not only is the incidence going up, but we're also seeing a lot of young breast cancers. And a lot of the breast cancers that come in are usually towards the late stages, and we need to change that trend. So why do we focus on this? Because breast cancer or any benign breast disease, when we pick it up at an early stage, the treatment is less radical and the quality of life is also very good after treatment. And you have simple tools to screen for breast cancer and breast diseases in your own home itself. So I'm going to start with the first step to detecting benign breast diseases and breast cancers at an early stage, and that is your self-breast examination. So self-breast examination is a very simple tool. You can do it at home, and there are multiple ways that you can do a self-breast examination. The easiest thing is to stand in front of a mirror, know what your normal breasts look like, know what your normal breasts feel like, and then if you diagnose or detect anything that looks different from your normal, reach out to a consultant. So people keep saying, when I do a self-breast examination, what am I really looking for? That is the first question that comes across. And the first thing that we tell them is, first get to know what's normal for you. So all women's breasts feel different, and sometimes your right and your left breast itself within an individual can feel different. So get familiar with what is normal for you. And anything that is different from the normal, such as a lump, a change in the skin, a change with your nipple, any discharge from the nipple or elsewhere in the breast, any of these changes need to be evaluated. So self-breast examination was the first thing we spoke about. And what is the second thing that you can do? So we have different screening modalities to look at breast diseases. So that we suggest for women over the age of 40, the mammogram, which is complemented with an ultrasound of a breast. We do not recommend mammograms in women over the age of 40, unless there is a specific indication, and this only comes from a medical oncologist or a breast consultant. So mammograms below the age of 40 is not something that we recommend. We do an ultrasound in age group, which can also be for screening. So these are the two common modalities, apart from your self-breast examination, that we would suggest to stay breast aware and pick up early signs of changes in the breast. So what are these common changes that we see? What are these diseases that we talk about in the breast? And I'll come to cancers last. I think the most common thing we see is breast pain. So a lot of people complain of breast pain very commonly. And though most of the breast pain, 80% of the breast pain that we have, is not very sinister or worrying or concerning, we still need to get it evaluated. So a lot of the time pain comes in during your menstrual cycle. This is something we don't need to worry about. It settles a lot with your menstrual cycle. You can forget about it and don't worry about it. But that is down medication. Then you need to come and get evaluated and see what's the cause for this breast pain. The second common thing that we see are lumps. Now, lumps we see are cancerous. Rest of them are all benign. So the first thing you need to do when you note a lump in your breast, do not remember that. Most of them are benign. But if they are benign or innocent, you still need to know what is this lump, because there are various types of lumps that you can have in the breast. Is this lump that is something that can cause a cancer? You now know a cancer can appear within it, or is it going to be something that is innocent and I can leave behind in my breast? So there are some lumps that are seen commonly in women that we don't like to operate on. You leave it alone, they don't cause harm, they don't convert to cancers, and they can just be left alone. But for this, you need to be evaluated first, know that it is an innocent lump before you decide to leave it alone. So these are the two most common symptoms that we see within the breast. Thirdly, the next common thing that women see is nipple discharge. So nipple discharge is nothing but any abnormal leakage that comes up from the nipples, and it can be either from one side or from both sides. And just as your breast lumps, your nipple discharge is also innocent most of the time. Only when you notice a bloodstain discharge do you need to get evaluated, consider having treatment or surgery for it. So as I said, most of our benign diseases in the breast are innocent, we don't worry about them. Now coming to the cancers, which is what people are most worried about, I think what people need to know is that we're in an era where we have tools to diagnose precancerous cells, so you can diagnose a cancer before it even comes. You can diagnose cancers at an early stage, which means you can even find a cancer before it is felt by your hand during a self-test examination. And when the disease is found in these stages, people do really well. Your survival outcomes are really good. We see people who live for a good 25, 30 years without any troubles or recurrence of the cancer. And of course, you'll need to have follow-ups. You'll need to have certain investigations done through the years. But mostly your quality of life is very good at this stage. The problem with diagnosing breast cancer at later stages, so people who neglect their breast, people who don't look at their breast, people who don't examine their breast and miss out on lumps that are growing within there and have had them for a long period of time. When you come in to us at this stage, treatment is a bit challenging, but remember, we still have treatment. So no matter what stage of cancer you present, there are treatment modalities that are available. It can be quite consuming for a person, but once you get through the treatment, quality of life is quite good, and these are the reasons why the fear for cancer need to go away. Now what I commonly tell people is, you don't think twice to go get a blood test done to know if you're diabetic or not because there's a family history. So why not go get a mammogram done as a screening tool if you have a family history? It's the same thing. If you find out you're diabetic, you know that there's treatment for it. It's lifelong treatment that you need to take. There are certain restrictions in life once you're diagnosed, but you get on with it. And it's the same thing when it comes to breast cancer. We need to stop fearing the word cancer. We need to say that yes, we can find it. We find it, we will be able to fight it, and once we fight it, we get on with life as normal as we can. Yes, it is challenging for people. It is a lot of turmoil for the people going through treatment. Treatment is prolonged, it goes on for about 6 months to a year. So it can be quite exhausting for patients, but we have a support team, we have support systems, and that's why we're here. We're here to help you go through that journey. So I think one thing that I would like to stress on again is that screening is very important. So screening in terms of doing a self-test examination at the appropriate age groups, which should be 25 years and above until you can continuously do it, your mammograms. So how often do you do this screening program? How often do you do a self-breast examination? And commonly we say do a self-breast examination once a month. So for premenopausal women, so women who are still having regular menstrual cycles, do the self-breast examination 3 to 5 days after you've completed your, because your breast is less heavy, less painful, and you can examine them quite well. If you're postmenopausal and you don't have regular periods, set aside one day of the month and make sure you examine yourself every day in that month. So this is the way you do a self-breast examination. Very good tool, and everybody should be doing it. All women should be doing it. All men with a strong family history of cancer should also examine their breasts every now and then, because men can also get breast problems and breast cancer, so they also need to be aware. Though it's uncommon in them, it is still possible. Now the second screening tool that we keep barking about is your mammograms. So what we don't want is people listening to health talks and going in for a mammogram without knowing what that mammogram is going to implicate for them. So what you need to know is, everybody first over the age of 40, if you're eligible for a mammogram, is still to get a consultation with your physician or with your doctor. Know that it is indicated for you. Check with them what it means for you before you go ahead and do a mammogram. Secondly, do them once in 2 years if you have absolutely no risk factors. So people without a family history, people without any other risk factors for cancer, do it once in 2 years. Don't do it very often. It is not going to give you any benefit. And don't go on with your imaging again without any consultation or advice. Now, the reason why we say get a consultation is because when you do a mammogram, if we do pick up an abnormality in it, you need to be prepared for what comes next. And this is where your consultation comes into play. So if you consult a physician or a doctor or your family doctor about a mammogram, they'll tell you, this is why you need to have it done. This is the possible things that they might pick up. And you need to be ready for that. So once your mammogram is done, you're okay with whatever results come by. So these are the common things that we generally do. Now, the third modality of screening is an MRI. So we've been stressing screening over the age of 40. So what do you do with someone below the age of 40 who's got a high family history of breast cancer and is at high risk? You do an MRI. So an MRI of the breast is something that is slightly more sensitive. It picks up even the smaller, finer changes, but it is a test that involves contrast, and hence you still need to consult a physician before you do a MRI. So don't do screening without consulting a physician except for your self-breast examination, which can be done at home. So the next common thing that people ask is, I've done a self-breast examination, I've picked up something, I've had my mammogram, what happens next? So in the breast, commonly we do something called a triple assessment. So a triple assessment is nothing but a consultant who examines your breast, which is called a clinical breast examination. Then you proceed to have your imaging, which will be your mammogram or the ultrasound, which we've already spoken about. And the third thing that we advise people for any breast abnormality is a breast biopsy. So a breast biopsy is a very simple test that can tell you what these abnormal cells exactly are. Are they something that you need to worry about, or can we leave it alone? So how you go about this test is they put a little needle in through the breast, take out a little bit of tissue, and we send it off for testing to look at it under the microscope. So sometimes it can just be normal tissue that gives off an abnormal image, and then that's good news, we don't need to worry about it. Sometimes you find abnormal cells that we may think, okay, this might turn into something later on, so we need to act on it now. Or sometimes you get the unfortunate diagnosis of a cancer. But whatever your results come back as, remember we have treatment. So why do all these stages of early detection? Not only will your quality of life be better, but you can also undergo a breast conserving surgery, which means the earlier you come in with a cancer, so the sooner a cancer is detected, the smaller the size of the cancer in proportion to your breast. Nowadays, we do have options to remove the cancerous cells with some normal tissue and leave behind the breast without causing any major deformity for a woman. Now, it's a topic that people don't like to talk about too often because it is associated with body image, but it is equally important for a woman's psychological well-being. So that's the second reason why we need to have early detection through screening, is to make sure that our surgical treatments are not as radical, and your following treatments such as your chemotherapy, your radiotherapy, all of it becomes less extensive, less aggressive, which means there's lesser damage and exposure to your body to all these medications, and better quality of life, better, easier quality of life. You recover from the treatment process also a bit quicker. So that is another reason why it is important to have early detection. Now, apart from cancers, I'll touch a little bit on the aspect of risk reduction. So when we look at cancer, who is at risk and who is not at risk? All women are at risk. And as you go with age, your risk increases. So what do we do about it? A, first find out that there are certain risk factors that we can modify. So those are risk factors that we can actually do something about. And then you have risk factors that you cannot modify. So what do you do in that group? Know what those and then you decide whether you need to screen more regularly or not due to your risk. So what are these modifiable risk factors? So modifiable risk factors are obesity. So we've found a very high risk of breast cancer purely because the fatty tissues also release estrogen, which is a hormone that causes changes in the breast and can also at times cause breast cancer. So maintain your BMI, eat healthy, exercise regularly, maintain your BMI to reduce the risk of cancer due to obesity. The second thing is alcohol and smoking. So we know that there is a relationship with alcohol, smoking and breast cancer. The more you consume and the longer you do it for, the higher the risk for breast cancer. So moderate it, avoid it altogether if you can. And thirdly, avoid taking pills that are not required. So you have oral contraceptive pills which contain estrogen hormones within them. And though this is given for birth control, though it's given to regularize your menstrual cycles at times, make sure that you shorten the duration as much as possible, because this estrogen again adds to your endogenous estrogen, increasing your risk for breast cancer. So these are the three modifiable factors that you need to keep in mind. Remember that we can take charge of these three factors and we can reduce our risk as far as these factors go. Now, when you come to the non-modifiable factors, it's the factors such as your family history. So those who've got a very strong family history of breast cancer, those who have first childbirths, you're more at risk. Those who don't have any children at all, with the increased estrogen exposure. So these are factors that we don't have control about, but we know that these are factors that we've inherited and we need to screen more routinely, be more aware, because there's no other way of reducing these risks. So these are the things that I would keep in mind. Remember that there are certain things that we can do to reduce our risk for breast cancer, stay aware of our risk, educate ourselves about it, and approach or consult a physician when you have a doubt. Don't delay. I think delay is what makes treatment also more challenging and more radical. So don't delay anything that you notice. Even a small sign, a small change in the breast can give you a lot of information for early detection, which can then help us give you less radical treatment. So remember that. Now, when I speak about breast cancer, I need to make sure people understand it is a disease that's commonly seen in women, but men can get it too. Men can also have breast cancer and other benign breast diseases. So reach out. Don't feel embarrassed. This is a norm. It can happen. And if you notice anything, don't delay presenting to the clinic. And also your gender fluid community. So I think I want to touch a little bit about breast cancer, the gender fluid community, because that's something that's not spoken about very often. And people need to know that even as a trans woman, when you have breast augmentation, either through surgery or through medication, then you increase your risk of breast cancer too. So you need to screen as well. You need to have your normal mammograms. You need to do your self-breast examinations as well. So it's a disease that reaches all different communities, all different age groups. And everybody needs to be more breast aware to fight the disease. So there's a question that says, is breast cancer genetic? Breast cancer can be genetic. Not all breast cancers are due to genetics. So a little bit more on that. Having a family history and then inheriting a genetic mutation are two different things. So you can have a very strong family history of breast cancer. So say a mother, a grandmother, a sister that has breast cancer may not inherit a specific gene that causes it, may not inherit a gene that we are aware of as of today, but they have a high risk. And those are the people that need to be more aware in that family. When it comes to genetic mutations, there are certain genetic mutations such as your BRCA1 and 2, the most common ones that we see, that are associated with breast cancer. And we advise people with a strong family history to check for these genetic mutations. Having a genetic mutation doesn't mean that you will get the breast cancer as well. It just means that you are at higher risk and screen more routinely. So instead of screening once in 2 years, screen annually. That's what we would suggest. Now, there are options for risk reduction as well. So if you have a family member that's had a breast cancer that has tested positive for a genetic mutation associated with breast cancer, and you as the next generation also test positive for the mutation, you do have options to do risk reduction. So we have options where we can reduce your risk of breast cancer over the years, sometimes surgical, sometimes medical, and I think that needs to be decided with your physician. You need to have that conversation with your physician as to which modality is best suited for you. But there are options. And I think what you need to know as far as genetics go is only 25% of the breast cancers we see are inherited due to genetic mutations. 75% of the breast cancers that we still see are sporadic, which means we don't know why they occur. It could be due to the risk factors mentioned previously, but most of the time they're idiopathic. We don't know why they come, and we don't know why they come at younger age groups when there is no family history as well. So there's somebody who said, how often should I go to my doctor for a checkup? You don't need to regularly go to a physician if you learn to do a self-breast examination the right way. The right way being stand in front of a mirror with your hands raised so you can inspect your breast. Then use the flat of your forefingers, go around palpating the breast. Don't forget to examine your armpits as well. So if you learn to do a good self-breast examination, you don't need to go to a physician routinely to have them check it for you. You should be able to pick up changes in your breast once you master the technique of a self-breast examination. And if you find anything different, go to your doctor then. If you have a doubt, go to your physician then. If you feel that you've had a mammogram a year back and you're still not eligible for your second screening mammogram, but you are worried or concerned about something, get a consultation then. So you don't have to routinely go at set spaces and times. If you know how to do a good self-breast examination, you can do your own checkups at home as far as your breast care goes and come to us when you find something wrong. I think because we've had this question of how often do I go for a checkup, there are two things I see quite often in the clinic. People coming in saying, I didn't know I needed to check my own breast. So whoever is listening in today, encourage your female friends, your family members, your daughters, just encourage as many people as you can to do a self-breast examination. And the second thing we get very often is, oh, I've had my ovaries removed, I've had surgery done for my ovaries and my uterus, why do I still need to check my breast? And purely because of one of the modifiable risk factors that I told you about. Obesity links to breast cancer because of the estrogen coming out from your fatty cells. Now, even if you're not obese and you're a postmenopausal lady who's finished all your menstrual cycles, you still have estrogen coming out from the fat cells, which means you still have a risk. So you still need to screen, you still need to get checked, you still need to do a self-breast examination. And as far as regular checkups go, for those who are on fertility treatment, I think it's good to have your breast examined by a specialist once in 3 months, because there's a lot of hormonal variations that happen with fertility treatment, and these hormonal variations will cause changes in the breast. So it's best that while you're on fertility treatment, go for a once in 3 months checkup. So I'll ask you a question. I don't know how many people are listening in today, but for those who are here, could you just leave a little message on the chat box? If at all you practice self-breast examination, let me see how many people actually already practice it at home. And since there are no further questions, I'll give you a little bit of information about breastfeeding and care earlier. So during pregnancy, during breastfeeding, you still have a lot of changes that occur in the breast. It's very difficult to pick up early signs such as in the breast because your breasts are lumpy at that time. But just remember that you can have lumps that come up during breastfeeding, which may not just be a clogged milk duct. Sometimes you can get fibroadenomas during breastfeeding. You can also get cancers associated with pregnancy. So pregnant women, breastfeeding women, I know you think that, you know, you're going through this process, there's no harm in doing a self-test examination. You also need to do it as well. You're also prone to having breast diseases. So even during that time, in fact, during that time, you need to be a bit more vigilant about your self-test examination. Okay, now coming to this, there's someone who says, I haven't done this before, I'll do it now. So I hope there's more people who will do it after this session. I'm not going to explain to you in more detail about how it's done. I think there are enough videos out there showing how to do a self-test examination. And there's few people who say, yes, we do it as well. So it's good to hear. All right, any more questions? I think we have only a few more minutes left.